Dr. Chandra, may I make a suggestion?
Of course. What is it, Hal?
This is a very unusual phenomenon. Don't you think I should abort the countdown so that you can remain to study it?
Chandra, get on a headset.
Use the private channel.
Okay. Now you gotta talk quickly. Persuade him to continue the countdown. I don't care what you tell him. Only don't let him stop.
5 minutes to ignition. Dr. Chandra, I'm ready to stop the countdown if you want.
No, Hal, don't stop.
I am fully confident in your ability to study the phenomenon by yourself. I have complete faith in you.
Propellant tank pressurization completed. Voltage steady. Are you sure you are making the right decision? I think we should stop. 4 minutes to ignition. I enjoy working with human beings and have stimulating relationships with you.
We enjoy working with you, Hal, and we will continue to do so even if we are separated by great distance.
Good God. Color. It's fading.
It seems to be losing its chemical strength.
I think we should stop the countdown, Dr. Chandra.
No. Don't do that.
This behavior is inconsistent with logic, Dr. Chandra. This phenomenon is too important to leave, unless it represented danger. Do you think there is danger here?
Something wonderful is going to happen. Something wonderful has happened. This guy has done the sequel to 2001, The Space Odyssey. This is the director, Peter Hyams, of 2010. Can you really do anything you want on film, Peter? Anything?
Can I? Mm-hmm. No. One can, though. I mean, somebody can. I think the grown-ups can.
You mean, technically, you think we're at that point, that you can do anything you want?
I think we've always been at that point. I think it is the Kubricks and the Lucases and the Spielbergs and the David Leans of the world who don't accept limits. And if something can't be done, they figure out a way to do it.
Well, Kubrick was making The Shining. And are you familiar with the book, so that you know that the topiary, which was all of that grass,
yeah,
the trees and the shrubbery, that was supposed to move in to attack the little boy? Kubrick couldn't get it. He technically couldn't get it. And that's why they built the shrubbery, the maze, the way in which they had done it. Now, Kubrick should have been able to do that, shouldn't he have? Could you have done it?
I think Stanley Kubrick could, if he wanted to, would do whatever he wants. I think he's proven probably as much or more than anybody else in this medium that he is essentially boundless.
Was he ever approached to do this, Peter?
I really don't know, except if I was MGM, I sure would have asked him.
Did you call him or check
yeah.
with him at all?
Oh, sure. I mean, he's my idol. And I first wanted to see if it was okay with him.
Yeah?
He said it was okay with him. You know, he started something. There's a certain legacy and heritage to that in terms of quality.
How many times have you seen 2001?
Quite a few.
You saw it originally, what, 1968?
68, yeah.
You saw it repeatedly during that period of time, or just once initially, like the rest of us saw it?
No, I saw it 2 or 3 times then.
And then when it was decided that you would do this, did you watch it again and again?
Yeah, sure, I began to study it in terms of what not to do. I mean, I set out to make a film for people who haven't seen 2001.
Mm-hmm.
The only reason why I did the film was I found there was a chance to make a film that was so diametrically opposite to it that it couldn't be compared. The last thing in the world I'd ever do is try to make something similar to what somebody else did, much less to what somebody far better than I am did. So it was because I saw the chance to make a film that was so unlike the first one in terms of its tone, in terms of its content, and the fact that it's a linear, accessible story that I styled really as a thriller, a film that was very emotional, a film that aims for your heart in addition to your eye. That's why I agreed to do it, so that you really can't compare the two.
But do you think it helps, for those of us who are familiar with 2001, to pick up on some of the trends? Like, for example, when we saw it in the theater with the rest of the audience, like old friends, when Hal the 9000 computer came on with the same voice that was used in 2001, the audience clapped when they saw the Discovery for the first time. The audience clapped. It was like old friends.
Interesting, though, when the picture has been shown to groups of kids who have not seen 2001, they cheer when they see the discovery, and they're not cheering because they're recognizing the discovery. They happen to have been cheering because they were very appreciative of that sequence. A lot of those, a lot of that applause was not necessarily nostalgia, again, because we specifically chose some groups of people who have not seen 2001 and didn't know anything about it, because that's what the film was made for. And when those sequences came on the screen, especially in screenings for kids, they started to really cheer. I mean, it wasn't polite applause. And it was because they were seeing kinds of imagery that they really hadn't seen before.
Well, you know, you developed such a suspense when entering the old Discovery for the first time. It was almost like they were walking on sacred, hallowed ground. You got that, like there was somebody really there. Let me ask you, Peter, do you really think there's life in outer space?
I don't know how anybody could look up at the night sky and really be convinced that, that we're alone. I don't know how anybody could do that.
Why is it taking so long to make contact?
Oh, well, there are all kinds of scientific reasons. Most of them have to do with proximity.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of that, how scientifically accurate is this film?
Well, whatever is between this film and accuracy is not lack of effort. This is not a fantasy. It's taking place in a time period that's frighteningly close to the present. I have a 15-year-old son. I'm 41. In 2010, he'll be younger than I am. It's about now. So that all of the work in this film, from a design point, was done with Jet Propulsion Lab, was done by consulting with people like Boeing Aerospace, people from NASA, Arthur C. Clarke, the top industrial designers of the country. This is, in fact, very close to, in technique, what people who are involved in these areas think it's going to be like. I'm not asking people to suspend their belief. I'm asking people to actually believe it's going on. It's interesting, the technical advisor on the film that I work with the most, a man named Richard Terrell from Jet Propulsion Labs, who worked on the Voyager mission and the Jupiter mapping and the Io and Europa mapping, is coincidentally the man who about 2.5 weeks ago discovered a new solar system. And when talking with him last week, he said that they believe that there are 40 others out there, not too far, and they are the age or older than our solar system. This new one they think is quite young. So that if in fact the conditions for life are fairly similar, the chance of some kind of intelligence may be higher than we think.
Well, what a history you have behind you with Capricorn One and Badlands, and I just saw the Star Chamber the other day accidentally on cable. You're very impressive. Oh, very impressive.
Thank you.
And now 2010, wait till you see it. Even if you haven't seen 2001, it's really a very special picture.
Thank you very much.
Peter Hyams, thank you so much. Please stay tuned. There's a lot more to come as 10:11 Morning continues.